Welcome everybody. Today's opening panel will address the question of the relationship between capitalism and religion, and between capitalism and theology. So one could say that there are two conventional approaches to the question of the relationship between capitalism and religion. In the first case, religion is considered as a condition for the emergence of capitalism, or in some sense it is a force which a spiritual force which facilitates capitalism. One of such approaches is can be found in Max Weber's Protestant Ethics and the Spirit of Capitalism, where Protestantism, or particularly Calvinism, is considered as a force behind the emergence of capitalism in Northern Europe. On the other hand, we have approaches rather popular in traditional Marxist accounts where religion is treated as an ideology, so as an ideological phenomenon which originates in the last instance from the economic structure of society, or in the case of modern society, in capitalism. So it's a phenomenon which expresses, but maybe at the same time conceals or veils, this economic structure. So these two approaches, though they vary in some aspects, both basically have one preconception or presupposition in common. That is that they both treat capitalism basically as a profane and as secular phenomenon. Capitalism is considered as something which influences religion, or is influenced by religion, but is itself not a religious phenomenon. But here on this panel we will basically approach this question from another point of view. We'll adopt a different line of thought, which was basically initiated by Walter Benjamin, who claimed that capitalism itself is a religious phenomenon. It is structured as a religion, not so much in the sense that it's a new religion with some theological dogmas or sacred scriptures or texts, but more of a practical religion which functions as some sort of a compulsive cult. So in this panel we'll basically try to get to grips with this curious relationship and connection between capitalism and religion, and try to basically find out what specifically does it mean to say that capitalism is a religion, and also to address the question of the relationship between capitalism and specific forms of religion like Christianity and Islam and so on. Okay, so that's it for the introduction. Now I'd just like to present the panelists. So on my left, we have Sami Khatib. Sami Khatib teaches at the American University of Beirut. He was a researcher at the theory department of the Jan van Eyck Academy Maastricht, and earned his PhD degree in media and communication studies from Freie Universität Berlin. His main research interests are in Walter Benjamin studies, critical theory, art theory, modern continental philosophy, psychoanalysis, and German studies. His recent publications include a book on Benjamin's figure of the messianic, and articles on Benjamin, Marx, Brecht, and Nietzsche. And you know, we're going from the right to, from my right to the left. We have in the middle Elettra Stimili. She's currently a researcher at the Scuola Normale Superiore of Pisa. She's the author of numerous essays that focus on the relationship between politics and religion, with particular attention to contemporary thought. In 2011, she published Il debito del vivente, Ascesi e Capitalismo. I apologize for possible mispronunciations of Italian words. So this book will be published in English at Sunny Press in New York in 2016. And she also published Jakob Taube's Sovranità e Tempo Messianico, and in 2005 she wrote the book Debito e Colpa. And then on my far left we have Phil Homburg, who recently completed his PhD in social and political thought at the University of Sussex. His thesis examined the development of a materialist standpoint in the early writings of Walter Benjamin through the critique of post-Kantian forms of Romanticism, Empiricism, and Neo-Kantianism. Okay, I would like to ask everybody to sign the list of participants which will circulate around here. We will start now with Sami Khatib. The title of his paper is Capitalism as a Religion or Religion as Capitalism, Why the Former Cannot Do Without the Latter. Please, Sami.
Yes, thank you. Thanks for this introduction, and I will just start. Let's see how far we can go. My paper starts from the assumption that today's capitalism cannot operate without religion. The title of this year's Media School is indicative: Religion and Capitalism, easily translates into Religion as Capitalism or Capitalism as Religion. While writing this paper and thinking again about the political economy of religions as corporate enterprises, or Walter Benjamin's famous formula of capitalism as a religion, I had to remind myself that there is no such thing as capitalism. Understanding why this is the case tells us more about today's religions than any theological understanding of capitalism could ever offer. As argued by critical theorists since Marx, capitalism is not merely an economic system, but a specific social relation that reproduces and relies on political, theological, libidinal, symbolic, and so on, economies. Even non-Marxist theorists like Max Weber grasped the inextricable link of capitalist spirit and Protestant religion. In my paper, however, I contend that religion, in the age of its capitalist reproducibility, is not defined as a specific monotheist religion, but rather as a practice generating meaning with or without a codified set of beliefs. In his fragment Capitalism as Religion from 1921, Benjamin characterized capitalism as an a-theological religion, a cult religion of practice, as you have mentioned. If the capitalist religion is a religion of pure cult without dogma, as he put it, we could conclude that today's religions have responded to this challenge by providing capitalist practice, capitalist religious practice, with pragmatic theologies. With pragmatic, I mean that although it is necessarily dogmatic, the standpoint of theology does not offer any critical distance to capitalist practice. Religions have adapted to the practice of capitalism by filling the meaningless void of capitalist valorization and exploitation with religious meaning, whatever its specific content. In the age of capitalist realism, an age in which capitalism seamlessly occupies the horizon of the thinkable, to quote Mark Fisher, capitalism more than ever needs the religious production of meaning, communitarian spirit, and transcendent solace. Today, unlike in the age of Jung, Marx, and Feuerbach, religion cannot be an object of a materialist critique since its content has become too flexible. Religion has adapted itself to the demands of the neoliberal individual who calls for instant spiritual meaning for a life subjected to capitalism. Put differently, the critique of religion is futile on theological grounds once theology has become a flexible, pragmatic set of dogmatic rhetoric customized for instant religious consumption. In this sense, a religion is deprived of any specific theological content that could provide a symptomatic reading with an object of critique. A neoliberal religion with pragmatic values cannot anymore be read as a celestial form, a heavenly compendium of real social and political conditions, but functions as a marker of identity, community, and cultural difference, whatever the content of the latter. In a purely formal sense, religion is a semantic field among others. It can provide identity for what Marx calls character masks, individualized impersonators of political economic functions. In this neoliberal conjuncture, the functional place of religion is not to be found in establishing capitalism as the general relation of the social domain. Religion is not anymore the hotbed of a spirit of capitalism, as Max Weber characterized Protestantism, but a set of practices and beliefs that creates a phantasmatic division between capitalist practice and non-capitalist, i.e. religious spirit. In other words, in a world of global capitalism, religion gradually becomes not only the marker, but the main resource of the production of cultural difference, heterogeneity, and identity. The universalizing drive of capitalism thrives on and inherently reproduces its dialectical flip side, diversity, heterogeneity, and difference. And to this extent, I won't make any remarks on theological or religious specificity, but only in a purely formal sense will grasp religion as a marker of difference in an also differential way. And I'm relying here in this reading on Vivek Chipper, who convincingly argued that, to quote, "the universalizing drive of capital should not be assumed to homogenize power relations or the social landscape more generally. In fact," as Chipper goes on, quote, "capitalism is perfectly compatible with a highly diverse set of political and cultural formations. According to Marx, capitalism is the production and reproduction of a specific form, that is, the commodity form, which consists of a purely social relation devoid of specific material or cultural content. However, the capitalist accumulation of surplus value relies on the combination and transformation of existing social relations in order to establish its own specific relation, that is, the dialectics of capital and labor. Capitalism is thus a relation that makes other existing or emerging power relations productive." To this extent, I follow Chipper's conclusion that, quote, "capitalism is not only consistent with great heterogeneity and hierarchy, but systematically generates them." End of quote. Far from homogenizing, capitalism's false universalism thrives on cultural difference. Capitalism itself, as a global system, is culture. It consists in a relational framework of relations, which combines various culturally and socially framed power relations and thereby makes them productive, commensurable, and exchangeable. Today, the production of cultural difference is the side of religion. Even though religion is not reducible to the function, to this function, and vice versa, cultural difference also relies on other driving forces. Cultural difference, as I understand it here, is not merely a content or differential marker, but also a specific form of identity generated through the production of separations. From this perspective, the realm of religion becomes legible as a sphere of divisions which partake in essential capitalist separations, that is, the division between labor and the means of production, public and private, bourgeois and citoyen, circulation and production, exchange value and use value, state and society, and so on. You can actually read the entire Capital, Volume 1 of Marx, and you find all these essential dialectical splits. As a result, being subjected to capitalist relations of production is not perceived as a contradiction to religion and one's so-called religious, cultural, or national identity. And the few notable exceptions like theology of liberation or religious socialism prove this general rule. Capitalism and religion do not appear as irreconcilable. Of course, one could add immediately a footnote: if there is any monotheist religion, it could not be practiced in capitalism by definition. If there is someone who claims to be a monotheist in the religion of capitalism, according to Benjamin, must be a pagan. So it's basically, yeah, this is very clear. Everybody can count until one. It cannot be two. But this is, and why people still think they can count until one in capitalism is precisely the virtue of religion and its regime of separations and divisions, and I will come to this in a moment. So having a religion, being a member of a religious community, is a function of the modern subject and her constitutive divisions. But how are these divisions enacted in religion and partake in capitalist practice? In his short essay, In Praise of Profanation, Giorgio Agamben provided us with an instructive definition of religion. I quote, "Religion can be defined as that which removes things, places, animals or people from common use and transfers them to a separate sphere. Not only is there no religion without separation, but every separation also contains or preserves within itself a genuinely religious core." In this formal sense, religion is not about beliefs, convictions or theological dogma, but about practice, delimitations and fields of separation. Quoting the Roman jurist Trebatius, Agamben draws his major conceptual distinction from this definition. And quote, "Profane is the term for something that was once sacred or religious and is returned to the use and property of men." As we shall see, Agamben's key term profanation is not limited to the field of religion. In a general sense, profanation means giving things back to use, whatever the reason or meaning of the separation of things from their use was in the first place. And it is in this sense that he concludes, "We must distinguish between secularization and profanation. Secularization is a form of repression. It leaves intact the forces it deals with by simply moving them from one place to another. Thus, the political secularization of theological concepts, the transcendence of God as a paradigm of sovereign power, does nothing but displace the heavenly monarchy onto an earthly monarchy, leaving its power intact. On the contrary, profanation neutralizes what it profanes. Once profaned, that which was unavailable and separate loses its aura and is returned to use." Again, Agamben's definition remains on a formal level. If profanation is the deactivating reversal of sacralization, sacralization is simply an affirming displacement of the logic of sacralization from one field to another, from religion to political economy. And of course, this is exactly the move that Marx does in Capital Volume 1, when he will use the outdated terminology of the critique of religion to criticize political economy. But the reason is precisely that the logic of sacralization is still in displaced mode, a displaced form in power in secularization. So the logic of sacralization is division and separation. The sacrifice, the banned zone, the holy site, the magic object, singled out and deprived of its profane use value. With these introductory remarks, Agamben puts forth an intriguing reading of Benjamin's fragment, Capitalism as Religion. Again, a quote from the short essay by Agamben. "We could say that capitalism, in pushing to the extreme a tendency already present in Christianity, generalizes in every domain the structure of separation that defines a religion. Where sacrifice once marked the passage from the profane to the sacred, and from the sacred to the profane, there is now a single, multiform, ceaseless process of separation that assails everything, every place, every human activity, in order to divide it from itself. This process is entirely indifferent to the caesura between sacred and profane, between divine and human. In its extreme form, the capitalist religion realizes the pure form of separation, to the point that there is nothing left to separate. An absolute profanation without remainder now coincides with an equally vacuous and total consecration. In the commodity, separation inheres in the very form of the object, which splits into use value and exchange value and is transformed into an ungraspable fetish. The same is true for everything that is done, produced, or experienced, even the human body, even sexuality, even language. They are now divided from themselves and placed in a separate sphere, displaced, that no longer defines any substantial division, and where all use becomes and remains impossible. End of quote. Of course, if one would go into a close reading of that very dense passage, one has to come to terms to what Agamben thinks is use. And of course, use here is not capitalist use value. It's a different understanding, a different concept of use. And probably it should be traced to the modernist strands of non-capitalist thinkers like Bertolt Brecht. Benjamin also refers to Karl Kraus or Adolf Loos in architecture. So there is a different concept of use, obviously, in modernism at stake that is non-capitalist. But this would be another paper. For the moment, we have just to go with Agamben's concept of use. And of course, this kind of other use, non-capitalist use, again, this is not the reflexive flip side of exchange value as use value. This other dimension of use is impossible in this kind of capitalism as a religion, where absolute profanation coincides with its opposite and becomes tautological, total consecration at the same time. So in other words, capitalism is the false sublation of the Aufhebung, of the divisions already present in religion. Here's, of course, Protestant Christianity meant. By short-circuiting the very distinction of sacralization and profanation, capitalism can indeed be theorized as a religion and furthermore can accommodate religions within its divided spheres. Every object, human and place, is inherently divided, separated from itself. And again, here we encounter the internal split nature of the capitalist form of identity, the division between labor, the means of production, public, private, bourgeois, citoyen, circulation of production, exchange value and use value, and so on. Avoiding both a theologization of capitalism and a rationalization of religion, Agamben's reading of Benjamin focuses on the atheological, practical nature of the capitalist religion. In capitalism as a religion, the famous fragment, Benjamin argues that capitalism is a new pagan cult religion, in fact characterized by four traits: cult, permanent duration, guilt, schuld in German, it's also debt, and concealment. And the remaining time I will only focus on the first aspect, capitalism as a religion of pure cult without dogma or theology. Radicalizing Max Weber's argument on how Protestant spirit of capitalism contributed to the establishment of capitalism in Western societies, Benjamin claims that capitalism has fully emancipated itself, like a parasite, from its historical host, that is, the mythical pagan elements of Christianity, in order to finally, in capitalism, install its own cult as a mere cult, as cult practice without theology. Benjamin's key notion is cult, a paradoxical religious term denoting a religious practice without theology. And he writes, "Capitalism is a pure cult religion, perhaps the most extreme that has ever existed. Everything only has meaning with immediate reference to the cult. It has no specific dogma, no theology." End of quote. Benjamin probably knew Hegel's definition of the pagan cult, according to which in paganism, cult and everyday life are not separated. They form a practical unity. And the capitalist religion, as Werner Hamacher argues, quote, "Everything that has meaning is immediately identical with what it means. The sign is immediately the signified and its referent." End of quote. The magical feature of the capitalist cult resides in the very fact that there is no hidden kernel, no inner secret beyond practice itself. Capitalism, proceeding as a universal matrix of repetitive self-valorizations of value, of course that's a fetish of capital as automatic subject, as Marx put it, is indifferent to any kind of specific meaning. However, this theoretical indifference does not constitute an extra ideological world of transparent social relations. According to Marx's Capital, famous fetishism of commodities causes a structural inversion of social relations of men and things, or more generally, society nature. This essential misrecognition of capitalist acting is unconscious and practical, as Marx's biblical paraphrase has it. Sie wissen das nicht, aber sie tun es. They know it, but they do it. It is very telling that also Marx has to, quote Marx actually from Capital One, take flight into the misty realm of religion to find an analogy explaining the mysterious yet non-theoretical fetishism of commodities. Apart from obvious structural and historical parallels, Marx's extensive use of religious metaphors, biblical paraphrases and quotations raises the question whether religion and capitalism can easily be separated and metaphor and meaning signifier and signified. In the totalizing universe of capitalism as a pure cult religion, such distinctions lose their weight. Once religion has become an immanent phenomenon, the production of an immanent sphere of transcendence. If God's transcendence has fallen, as Benjamin put it in the fragment, he's implicated in the fate of man, that is, the capitalist cult religion. This immanent transcendence is itself not reflected in theological or theoretical terms, but is only of practical meaning. As Benjamin notes, quote, it contributes to the knowledge of capitalism as a religion to imagine that the original paganism certainly and most proximately grasped religion not as a higher moral interest, but as the most immediately practical, that it had, with other words, not been aware of its ideal or transcendent nature, just as today's capitalism is, but saw in the irreligious or individual or different faith an infallible member of its community. In precisely the same sense, the modern bourgeoisie sees its non-working members. End of quote. With regard to today's religions, we can add that the capitalist religion similarly regards its religious and non-religious members as part of its regime of separations. With Agamben, Marx, Weber and Benjamin, we can argue that capitalism substituted and formalized divisions already operative in Protestant Christianity. And of course you can move on try to find the same, the same formal structure of separation in other religions. The point, however, is that once capitalism installed and generalized its own social relation, that is, the commodity form, all other existing divisions and separations are put to their capitalist work. Religion, as a mode of sacralization, is at the same time profaned by capitalism's indistinctive cult nature. Not everything has only meaning once it is seen as the bearer of value, and resacralized in a realm outside of society's economic practice. And of course we could add, there is no such thing as a purely economic practice. As I said in the beginning, every economy is political, libidinal, theological, and so on. There is no such thing as economy, only in the pseudoscience of macroeconomics. That's why it's not a science. In today's capitalism, the very distinction between sacralization and profanation is shifted to another level in which religion is merely treated as one functional marker and resource, among others, to impose and develop divisions as cultural difference. Once capitalism as a pure cult religion has become the universal matrix of sacralization, commodity fetishism, and profanation, all that is holy is profaned, religion partakes in capitalism's regime of separation. These separations are mostly spatialized. It comes as no surprise that religion, as a capitalist mode of spatial domination, is put to practice where gated communities, neo-colonial land grabs, sectarian inclusions and exclusions are to be legitimized. I mean, the history of Yugoslavia tells this story quite well. Lebanon, the civil war there, is another case. But generally, from here on, one could actually start a whole investigation into the spatialization of history in today's capitalism. That's actually a territory Fred Jameson has studied for the last 20 years. and to look what is the functional place of religion in this conjuncture of the spatialization of history and of domination. But this would be another paper. So against this capitalist reproduction of religious separations, Agamben calls for a non-capitalist form of profanation. And I think I will rest my case here to maybe in the discussion we can see what kind of profanation, non-capitalist profanation, this could be. And he writes, "For to profane means not simply to abolish and erase separations, but to learn to put them to a new use, to play with them. The classless society is not a society that has abolished and lost all memory of class differences, but a society that has learned to deactivate the apparatuses of those differences in order to make a new use possible, in order to transform them into pure means. Nothing, however, is as fragile and precarious as the sphere of pure means. Play in our society also has an episodic character, after which normal life must once again continue on its course. No one knows better than children how terrible and disquieting a toy can be once the game it forms a part of is over. Thanks for your attention. We will discuss what that means later."
Thank you very much, Sami. We will continue with Elytra Stimili, who will talk about practices of life and the religious character of capitalism. Please, Elytra.
Yes, thank you very much to the organizer for the invitation. And so today I will try to focus on the relationship between religion and capitalism that is at the core of our discussion. And to this end, I will focus not so much on the dogmatic and the theological aspects of religion, but on the practices of life at the basis of religion as a social phenomenon. So in recent years, the link between politics and religion was again at the core of the public debate. However, I think that a new reflection that specifically takes into account the religious dynamics within the current economic power can be very important today. And I believe that such a reflection can be crucial to understand what is at stake in the enormous transformation that was at the origin of the current economic crisis. In the Western world, the political debate has focused on the potential or limits of a global, multi-religious and multicultural society, and the focus became the so-called clash of civilizations. But I think that the core of the issue remains fundamentally unresolved. The motivations and root causes of this phenomenon are still unclear. From my point of view, a radical confrontation with the concurrent dissolution of global politics into economy, or rather with the huge transformation undergone by politics through its blending with the economy, may perhaps be of help in the challenging search for an explanation of the renewed supremacy of religion on the public global scene. For example, in this context, can we assume that the recently emerged and developed Islamic fundamentalism arise from the need to find a response to the hegemony held by the religious apparatus of the world economic power? Can we assume that the new fundamentalism arise from the an attempt to find a response to the hegemony of capitalism as religion? This is the hypothesis that I will propose here. Until now, the paradigm of secularization has defined the peculiar phenomenon through which the Western societies and political life have progressively distanced themselves from the forms of sacred conduct. This paradigm is still referred to as a legitimate historiographical category, for example, by Charles Taylor. Habermas talked of post-secular societies. In any cases, the underlying assumption of the Western debate is the diachronic and the continuous development as the prerequisite for the transition from the religious sphere to the political domain. This development can be understood as either progress or decline, but it is never as such completely problematized. In recent years, an interesting discussion on the relationship between politics and religion involved also some influential Italian philosophers. In this instance, the paradigm of secularization has been called into question through a renewed use of the political theology category. The analysis of the relationship between the political and the religious domain is focusing on the synchronic tension between the two, rather than delving into their diachronic development. For example, in the book The Kingdom and the Glory of Giorgio Agamben, or in the book of Roberto Esposito entitled Due. Both Esposito and Agamben consider the theological, political, and the economic political apparatuses as linked, and therefore they analyze common points more than differences. However, from my point of view, a profound discontinuity exists between the recent neoliberal policies and the past forms of politics that are still attached to the legal structure of national sovereignty. A discontinuity that is becoming increasingly visible, and which, I believe, poses questions worthy of further investigation. According to me, the point is to understand the mechanisms that allowed the current economic power to intertwine with single lives in a manner so widespread and unprecedented forms. In a way, this bond has been ever present. As Marx showed, the capitalist economy has always established an intimate connection with individual lives, a relationship that was fundamentally based on the exploitation of specific skills in the form of labor. What has changed in the present is essentially that such a relationship is no longer confined to specific performance, but it now extends to the whole of life and to the human ability to evaluate it. Nowadays, the very processes and the procedures of subjectivation by which individuals construct their own individual subject increasingly tend to coincide with the forms that economic power has taken on these days. This is especially evident in the process of financialization of the economy and in the phenomenon of debt. the new sophisticated financial products are directly related to the development of unprecedented forms of private debt. The private debt, the form of private debt that is related to the private life, is intimately related to the new products of financialization. This calls for a rethinking of the bond between the modes of existence of individuals and the global economic management. So, the purpose of my paper is an analysis of some aspects focused by three authors: Weber, Benjamin, and Foucault. I'm particularly interested in their critique of the capitalist economy beyond the strictly economic field. Areas seemingly unrelated to the economy emerge as essential in this analysis to understand the fact that if there is a religious mechanism that governs today in the predominance of neoliberalism, this is not related to theology, but to the effectiveness of the religious practices. That is, what is at stake here is not the structure or else the superstructure of the theology, but the effectiveness of the religion as practices of life. So, first, I would like to focus now on the Walter Benjamin's fragment, Capitalism as Religion, that is at the core of our discussion today. Secondly, I would like to relate some aspects of Benjamin's analysis with that of Weber and Foucault. Finally, I would like to depict the Christian roots of the religious mechanism that moves that capitalist economy in the sense of Benjamin, Weber, and Foucault. So, first point. What is of particular interest for the purpose of my analysis is that by defining capitalism as religion, Benjamin intends to examine the link between the two areas, not in the light of the historical development of secularization, but rather in reference to a connection which, in many ways, resembled that structure between theology and politics presented by Carl Schmitt in his famous text of 1922, entitled Political Theology. Yet, it is not Benjamin's intention to provide a proof of the religious structure of capitalism as Mead did regarding state sovereignty. From Benjamin's point of view, in fact, it is not so much about confirming the structural analogy between religion and economy, nor about outlining the process of the ideological dependence that would make it evident by exposing the inherent dysfunctions of the capitalist economy. Benjamin's focus is rather on the very functioning of a historically determinate mechanism that appears infallible. I would so concentrate with Benjamin on the mechanisms that even today, or perhaps more today, contribute to making capitalism a religion. In order to do so, I will focus in particular on what Benjamin describes as the first characteristic of capitalism as a religion. In the fragment of 1921, Benjamin says, in the for her Yes. So Benjamin says, in the first place, capitalism is a purely cultic religion, perhaps the most extreme that ever existed. In capitalism, things have a meaning only in their relationship on the cult. Capitalism has no specific body of dogma, no theology. Hence, for Benjamin, not only does the very structure of capitalism itself mirror a religious configuration, but more importantly, such structure lies outside the domain of dogmatism and theology. It is not about adapting to the truth of a state of affairs, nor about the need for an authority that recognizes or legitimizes. It rather fulfills merely practical purposes. It is a practice that does not require a theoretical system, nor a transcendent order to legitimate its actions. In this respect, it is significant that in defining capitalism as an essentially religious phenomenon, Benjamin refers to Max Weber's famous thesis that the capitalism economy originated from the innerworldly Protestant asceticism. The reference to Weber is here expressed as criticism. According to Benjamin, capitalism is more than just a merely religiously conditionated construction, as might be assumed based on the category of secularization employed by Weber to explain the origin of capitalist economy. In Weber's view, the Protestant piety, in its most extreme forms, such as Calvinism and Puritanism, allowed the process of disenchantment, which is the foundation of modern rationality and the resulting development of capitalist economy. However, the Weber's perspective appears more complex if we take into account the fact that he defines the religious conditioning of the economic power on capitalism rather than from the theological point of view in the light of the same ascetic conduct, electively consistent with the development of capitalist economy. The core of the capitalist domination, its spirit, as Weber would call it, is namely identified in those behaviors and forms of production of subjects, which, as in the case of innerworldly asceticism, are elected to adapt to the capitalist production mode. In this sense, one could say that while Benjamin criticizes Weber in his fragment, he actually does no more than radicalize Weber's approach. For both, the decisive to the development of capitalism as a religion is the effectiveness of its inbuilt religious practices and to themselves, rather than the creation of a theological apparatus. So I come to the second point. According to the Weberian perspective, the domination of capitalist economy is based on the intimate bond that economic power establishes with individual lives. The bookkeeping of existence implied in innerworldly asceticism, with its methodical control, means that the process of sanctifying life can almost take on the character of a business enterprise, the success of which is itself a sign of election. The same mechanism is at the basis of the capitalist enterprise, on which Weber's analysis is focused in many ways, anticipating recent events. The predominance of neoliberal policies has allowed the entrepreneur of himself. Both enterprise and entrepreneur at the same time, has allowed the entrepreneur of himself to play a central role in the economic dynamics, radically altering the categories at the basis of classic economics. And as lucidly highlighted by Michel Foucault in his cutting-edge studies on governmentality. Despite the criticism and the few explicit references to Weber, I believe this author has a decisive influence on Foucault's studies, in which the biopolitical perspective is intended for an approach to economy essentially aimed at identifying a form of power other than the juridical institution of the national state. A form of power emerges here connected to capitalist forms of production which exceeds the strictly economist perspective used in the mainstream critical literature. In this respect, Foucault speaks of governmental power in order to emphasize the deep connection between the technologies of government, which characterizes the economic power, and the practices of self-government. The practices of self-government that are at the basis of the techniques of production of subjects who are not so much subject to it, as in the cases of the legal institution or in other respects in the Marxian sense of work exploitation, but rather designed to manage and capitalize individual resources within its structure. Modes of subjectivation and forms of subjection are, in this sense, so closely related and represent governmental techniques. In many ways, these practices, this perspective is recalls Max Weber's work on the origin of capitalism. In these studies, Foucault's analysis is ultimately aimed at understanding the peculiar form of government at the basis of the new neoliberal policies. Within this scope, he identifies the Christian pastoral power as the prototype of the economic governmental power that has in neoliberalism its highest expression. This is particularly relevant for our discussion since it means to define the key role the Christian religion plays in understanding the religious and economic mechanism fostering governmental power beyond the strictly scientific, theoretical foundations ascribed to economy. When it comes to Christianity, what is of utmost importance to Foucault, above the institutions of its worldly supremacy, or its relation to political power, or even its theological elaborations, what is almost important to Foucault is its ability to govern man omnes et singulatim, that is, the ability to exercise a domination so global and yet capable of individualizing and penetrating into the most intimate and daily aspect of each individual life, into one's own forms of subjectivation. For Foucault, decay is then to bring into focus the ability of Christianity to invent this new technology of power, the governmental power, in fact, based on a peculiar form of obedience, which he calls poor obedience. It originated not so much from submission to the law, but rather from a bond that is established on the basis of free and governed self-conduct. It is a form of power that, rather than forcing individuals to perform certain actions, is aimed at determining their relationship with themselves. Foucault analyzes the pastoral power with the purpose of identifying a technique of government that is radically distinct from sovereign power, and in this sense different from its theological political approach. In this direction, Foucault's genealogy of modern governmentality, the analysis of the Christian pastorate, takes on the form of a radical deconstruction of political theology, which seeks to emphasize the continuity between the latter and the economic governmental power, rather than the contiguity between the two areas. I believe that Foucault outlines here a particularly crucial turning point, one that Benjamin had also, in a way, already perceived. In the fragment of 1921, Benjamin reflects on the role of Christianity within the Weberian thesis on the origin of capitalism, and identifies between the two a direct relationship, parasitic, he says, that somehow amplifies the historical scope outlined by Weber. His perspective is thus closely akin to that produced by Foucault. Consistent with his genealogical method, which aims to highlight the discontinuities more than the elements of continuity in history, Foucault not only tends to radicalize the heterogeneity that divides Christian pastoral power from the theological political logic that is typical of the modern state power, but he also recognizes a link between economic governmental power and Christianity, which is not direct to identify in the Christianism its pre-existing foundation. In this sense, the relationship between the two refers to the common mechanism they both feed upon, rather than to an historical evolution on the one into the other. In his view, the key footer of this bond is the direct parasitic derivation, as Benjamin called it, not the ongoing development. From my point of view, a study in this matter, more than outlining a historical evolution from the one phenomenon to the other, should rather shift the focus from the historical evolution to the mechanisms, the technologies, and the practices that characterize this form of power. And the final point, following the path that leads from Weber to Foucault through Benjamin, or rather that starting from Foucault, go back to Benjamin and therefore to Weber, it is not about outlining an evolutionary link between Christianity and Western economy. What matters here is not so much the fact that Christianity appears quite clearly to have played a central role in the development of capitalism for obvious historical and geographical reasons. In this way, the influence of religion on the economy would simply be reduced to a superstructure upon which the capitalist power is molded to achieve its objectives. In this sense, as seen in orthodox Marxist tradition, any non-strictly economic apparatus should rather be relegated to the subordinate role of ideology. Nevertheless, one of the most important lessons that, in my view, Foucault provided in his lectures on governmental power has been to turn the spotlight on the huge transformation brought about by neoliberalism, which developed and made explicit a premise that had been implicit in capitalism ever since its origin. That is, its nature of being a complex economic institutional system. This means that instead of deriving from an ideological superstructure that either embeds or promotes the economic system, the institutional field is an integral part of this, to the extent of contributing to its structure through a process that, on closer inspection, reproduces the same power mechanism originally found in Christian life. In this sense, capitalism, rather than a kind of economic production that the development of which could assiduously follow a natural law, is an economic institutional complex that allowed for a variety of different individual shapes, different elaborations of an institutional power apparatus. So much so that we may say that, in Foucault's view, there is not just a single capitalism, that of Western world, but rather numerous different capitalisms. Foucault's interest focused on defining the different ways of a power that is exercised only over free subjects, and only insofar as they are free. Hence, a power that has in freedom its necessary condition. According to Foucault, neoliberalism resolves around a new claim for freedom, characterized by a non-constrictive, yet far more widespread and efficient form of domination. By guaranteeing each person maximum freedom in the form of self-control and an investment upon individual skills and predispositions, neoliberal governmentality becomes the basis for a supremacy which ensures greater effectiveness. In this case, the power extended over lives is not just designed so as to define the limit of its own legitimate domain. The relationship between the two areas is rather built upon the development of ways through which the free exercise of power on the one hand and of the other and each individual's ability to mold our own life and to invest in our own skills are intertwined almost into sameness, as in, is the case with the most ruthless neoliberal policies. This is in fact what allowed the diffusion of the entrepreneur role into all areas of political and social life, promoting the conversion of the state, the states, into managerial states, and gradually transforming state sovereignty into global governance. In this system, market economy itself becomes a political institution which continually reshapes its own scope, also transforms the relationship between politics and law from within, tools promoting a radical change in the legislative production. This process was constitutive of capitalist economy, but the impact of such development became fully apparent following the expansion of neoliberal policies. I believe this is the starting point for tracing a genealogical bond with the Christian religious experience as trial field to new institutions, and so to understand the parasitic origin of capitalism with respect to Christianity as identified by Weber, even before by Benjamin, and take to extremes by Foucault. Ever since its origin, in fact, the experience of Christian life has been grounded on a critic of the legal form of power, a critic of the law, which translates into new experimenting of government strategies not directly ascribable to a fixed form of domination. In this sense, Foucault views in the Christianity the invention of a new bond, not only as coercive power, rather as a new institution in which individuals are personally and collectively involved precisely because they are free. The parasitic derivation of capitalist economy from Christianity may also perhaps shed new light on the meaning of death that was identified by Benjamin as the fundamental mechanism of capitalist religion as early as 1922, and that is the experience which characterizes our time. Today, exploitation is intrinsically linked as never before to the freedom of individual conducts and of the practices of life. The challenge of our time is to change this condition that seems at a network with no way out. This is a political challenge that requires new institutions and new political practices directly related to individual lives, I think. Thank you.
Thank you. The last presentation will be by Philip Homburg. The title of his presentation is Sign, Symbol, or Fetish Against the Sociological Understanding of Money. Please.
Thank you. So I'm going to start with Habermas. And when I was thinking of theorists of money, one of the I thought he was one of the last people that came to mind. So I was quite surprised to find just how extensive his discussion of money is in the theory of communicative, the second volume of the theory of communicative action.
Philip, please go close
it. Oh, sorry. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. In this text, Habermas engages with Talcott Parsons' notion of symbolically generalized media of communications. According to Parsons' understanding of this, of these types of symbols, they're signs that evolve within the context of human action, and as such can be generalized beyond their use in specific situations. So money measures and stands for utility, and in this case, utility equals value, but does not possess utility in itself. So it may act as a means to acquire useful things in exchange, but it doesn't possess use itself. Habermas is critical of this account. Systems of money and power stand for the social subsystems of the economy and politics. And we all probably are familiar with Habermas's distinction between system and life world. So the expansion of these systems into the life world is a process of what he refers to as colonization, something to be resisted. Power and money are described as autonomous, delinguistified media of communications. Yet at the same time, Habermas understands his money medium in analogy with language. He states, money is neither a commodity nor a productive factor, though it symbolizes amounts of value. As a medium, it has no intrinsic value. In this respect, it is not unlike the medium of language. So conceived as a sign, money is an arbitrary form of designation of the concept of value. We can talk about, you know, Habermas is obviously similar to Parsons as a kind of use value theory here. So the symbol and systems of money and power for Habermas are conceived of as essential to the functioning of highly complex societies. Habermas states that delinguistified media of communication, such as money and power, connect up interactions in space and time into more and more complex networks that no one has to comprehend or be responsible for. Money he still has to be distinguished from other communicative media, such as love and empathy. Habermas thus presupposes aspects of money that should not replace language as a consensual modes of communication. So money, in other words, borrows its symbolic character from language and even replaces language in certain respect, but no, shouldn't that replacement shouldn't be total or be a problem. So symbolic media such as money and power are necessary, but should be limited to the economic sphere in which they originate. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of the origin of this account of money as sign. And I'm going to look at Marx and also Habermas briefly. Understanding Marx's conception of money in the first volume of Capital is obscured in the English translation. Ben Folkes conflates Marx's use of the term psyche and symbol, and translate both as symbol. So in the English, it's consistently translated as symbol, even though Marx makes a distinction between sign and symbol. So this might seem picky, but I think there's a pretty good reason to be precise on the matter. Marx quite explicitly criticizes signal conceptions of money, which he believes are representative of the philosophers of the Enlightenment, Locke and Hume, and also Hegel. So when criticizing them, he uses the term sign. And as does Hegel. So in the philosophy of right, Hegel has a short description of money, and I'll read it here. The value of a thing may be very heterogeneous. It depends on need. If you want to express the value of a thing, not in its specificity, but in the abstract, then it is money which expresses this. Money represents any and everything, though it does not portray the need itself, but is only a sign of it. It is itself controlled by the specific value of the commodity. Money as something abstract merely expresses this value. So for Marx, Hegel expresses a conceptual and signal account of money, something that is mirrored in the sociological account. Now, something quite strange here is that in some ways, Hegel's account seems more appropriate for our contemporary reality, a reality in which the money, and the money commodity have been separated. Contrast to Hegel, but also in anticipation of the sociological account, Marx insists on deriving his account of money from the money commodity. So, like I said, this kind of at first glance seems obsolete. In contemporary society, money only has value specific social contexts. Marx, in contrast, begins with the assumption that money has value in relationship to other commodities. At its basic form, the money commodity, it belongs within the sphere of production, as a product of labor. It is only with this understanding that it is possible to develop an account of how more abstract accounts, abstract forms of money develop out of the money commodity, and how the commodity is eventually replaced by symbols. Thus, rather than presupposing an account of money as sign, something that merely represents value, Marx refers to its origin in the money commodity and the fetish character of that origin. The sociological account takes the finished form of money and capitalism and gives it the status of an a priori for modern society. In contrast, Marx's account allows for an account of money not simply derived from its purely conceptual form, and as such points to the fragility of more abstract systems of finance, credit, and so on. So, for Marx, capitalist society is one in which money becomes the nexus rerum et hominum, the nexus of things and man. Accordingly, this conception of money destroys all political and religious ties, something that simply cannot be understood within the Habermasian distinction between system and life world. Crucially, then, for Marx, money does not simply serve as a medium. This would be to concede that money only has a function in circulation, that it merely greases the wheels of exchange and lets human beings get down to business. As Marx states in the Contributions to the Critique of Political Economy, functioning as a medium of circulation, gold suffered all manner of injuries. It was clipped and even reduced to a purely symbolical scrap of paper. Its golden splendor is restored when it serves as money. The servant becomes the master. The mere underling becomes the god of commodities. So I'm going to turn now to an examination of the money fetish that Marx develops in Ethical Volume 1. Peculiar objects, specifically the commodity and money, structure the immediate sensuous reality of capitalism. Once the ordinary sensuous thing is produced for the purpose of exchange, Marx states, it changes into a sensuous, supersensuous thing. This is the double character of the commodity. It is a finite sensuous thing that at the same time is marked by a supersensuous, immaterial, or better yet, spectral social property. This is what Marx terms fetishism. A social, i.e. a supersensuous property, attaches itself to the object in the process of production. To the immediate sensuous perception of producers, the social reality between their private labors appears as what they are, i.e. they do not appear as direct social relations between people, but rather thing-like relations between persons and social relations between things. Ordinary sensuous things come to embody an invisible substance, value, that exceeds their determinate material shape. I think this is put exceptionally well by Lucio Coletti, who I think really gets this religious and symbolic quality of Marx's commodity form. Coletti writes, here Marx is saying that the commodity is a supersensate thing in a sensate manner, a natural body or use of our value, which harbors within itself a non-material objectivity, value. The commodity, just like the Christian, is the unity of finite and infinite, the unity of opposites, being and non-being together. The social essence of things is concealed in their immediate sensuous appearance, and the phantasmagoric reality of capitalism confronts human beings as an inverted world of alien objectivities. This objectivity is not a mistake, something that can be dispelled formally at the level of consciousness. Rather, this inversion is real, and it finds its confirmation in those objects that constitute capitalism's second nature. To fetishize the conceptual or supersensuous quality of the commodity is, in fact, to fetishize a quality of the object that is social, i.e. spectral and immaterial. At the same time, since value can only appear through things, the fetishization of the spectral property must take the form of the worship of crude material objects. This is what is particular to the commodity fetish in contradistinction to the religious fetish, for instance, in which the act of worship is supposed to bring the subject into a relationship to the divine and transcendent. So I'm going to talk about the money fetish in a little bit more specifically now. The money form develops as a result of a coincidence of a particular set of social processes. This is the coincidence between the need for a general equivalent to regulate exchange between private producers and the emergence of essentially useless but scarce vessel for this purpose, most commonly gold. What is crucial about this development for Marx is that the origin is lost in the result. The historical particularity along with the social, as opposed to natural objectivity of the money form, is hidden beneath its dazzling sensuous shape as the money commodity, as gold or silver. This is what Marx describes as the magic of money. that the physical object appears from the earth, emerged from the ground as money, i.e. as a direct incarnation of all human labor. The social mediation of this process is lost in the result, and commodities come to find their measure sitting both outside and among them in the form of a general equivalent. A social relationship between human beings becomes hidden in a material shell. What is crucial here is that money confronts us as something quasi-natural. Marx quotes, anyone can use, or Marx states, anyone can use money as money without necessarily understanding what it is. Unlike Habermas, however, who doesn't really think that this is a scandal, Marx does not take money's necessity for a complex society as an a priori. Rather, aims to grasp its specifically capitalistic form. Parsons and Habermas make a grave error when they understand money as a sign, as something contingent, not in specific form and emergence in capitalism. The contingency of money is confounded by the fact that it seems to posit its own logical necessity and objectivity, something that is enforced by the brute fact that in capitalist society, human beings require money to sustain their existence. Access to the sphere of production, and in turn, to social reproduction, is mediated by money. It is therefore impossible to separate money from capitalist forms of domination, compulsion, and exploitation. So in light of this, is it not enough to recognize that money conceals within itself the historical development of specific social relations? While this is certainly necessary, I think it misses what Marx recognizes as a general, genuine power of money. As Marx states in the Grundrisse, the special difficulty in grasping money and its fully developed character as money is that it's a social relation. A definite relation between individuals here appears as a stone, as a purely physical external thing that can be found as such in nature, and what is indistinguishable in form from its natural existence. The difficulty with grasping the conceptuality of money is that when it's conceived purely as the medium of exchange, it exists squarely within sensuous reality. However, at the same time, money is not simply a material thing. It embodies, not merely represents a concept, value. If it were not the embodiment of a concept, then we would simply be dealing with a round metal disc or a piece of paper. It is in money, therefore, that the concept gains a foothold in reality. If we were to separate either of its two sides, its conceptual essence and its material appearance, we would no longer be talking about money. On the one hand, we would be talking about a mere thing, or on the other hand, something wholly conceptual, but lacking a determinate shape. As money, however, we're talking about something that holds these two sides in an impossible, but apparently perfect unity. It is only as a material thing that the concept becomes grounded in reality and the experience of individuals. It is this double character of money as a sensuous thing that pervades every aspect of our existence, and as a supersensuous social relation that transcends the finitude of its own sensuous shape, that money holds the reality of capitalism together and comes to structure social relations between individuals. As something that fundamentally structures reality, the power of money cannot be grasped simply by recognizing it as an arbitrary sign, as a designation of value, or something that merely masks an underlying social relationship. The essence of money must appear, the essence of money value must appear, and this appearance takes place through a material thing. So I'm going to turn to Benjamin now, and specifically his critique of a certain type of idealist symbol. I think it'll shed some light on the conflict between these two forms. So in his Trauerspiel book, Benjamin makes use of the same quote from Faust that Marx uses to describe the sensuous, supersensuous nature of the commodity. The unity of the sensuous and supersensuous object, this is Benjamin, the paradox of the theological symbol is distorted into a relationship between appearance and essence. This is what he thinks is characteristic of a form of a symbol that arises in Romanticism, especially. So Benjamin's conception of the paradox of the religious symbol can assist us in understanding the difference between two types of symbols: the theological symbol and the concept of the symbol that dominates our modern understanding from Kant to Habermas. This will in turn allow me to say a few things about money. Benjamin offers some hints about the religious symbol in his outline for his book on the Trauerspiel. The essence of the religious symbol is the unity of the sign and the intention that fills the object, Benjamin writes. The example Benjamin uses is the Eucharist. The bread is the body of Christ, he writes. In the traditional Catholic understanding, the sacramental union, the bread does not mean Christ, the bread is Christ. In the act of communion, the bread and wine is transformed into the body and blood of Jesus. its physical qualities as bread, you know, it's white, it's soft, disappear. This is demonstrated, Benjamin states, by the way in which predictive judgments just dry up. In relation to this strange object, predictive judgments drawn from experience simply do not hold sway. The object is imaginary, and the unity found in this object is what Benjamin refers to as objectively intentional. The symbol's unity is actualized in the act of taking communion. The essence of the symbol, as Benjamin states, is the unity of the sign and the intention that fulfills the object. In communion, the semblance of unity is overcome, and the symbol appears as a totality, a true identity of a material thing and a supersensuous concept. The symbol gains its status as both real and ideal, sensuous and supersensuous, in the fulfillment of its ideal function as the body and blood of Christ. Its material existence is transcended, and it becomes divine. For the religious symbol to become meaningful and real, it must serve an end, and this occurs in the act of worship. It is only in the service of such an end that the symbol transcends its own finite existence and becomes identical with itself, a whole. This is not merely the logic of substitution. Rather, the object appears other than itself in the act. In this sense, the religious symbol corresponds to the original Greek symboline, meaning to gather up and unite. So this is the religious symbol, and I think Benjamin gives a nice quote from Frederick Kreutzer, who is a colleague of Hegel's, on its four qualities, and that is the momentary, the total, the inscrutability of its origin, and the necessary. So now, how are we to understand the concept of the symbol that arises in German idealism, particularly Romanticism? Benjamin's quite clear that the notion of the symbol, he states, has nothing more than the name in common with the genuine notion. For Benjamin, this religious symbol begins to become degraded in the classicist antithesis of the mystical and the plastic symbol. What dominates the religious or mystical symbol is the inexpressible that, in its infinitude, ultimately dominates its earthly form. In contrast, the plastic symbol resolves this conflict between the sensuous and the supersensuous, by reducing the concept to its natural form. So Benjamin says, in doing so, the conflict between the infinite and the finite is therefore resolved by the former becoming limited and so human. The thing is the manifestation of an idea, and as such, distorts the essence of the religious symbol. The material thing is hollowed out, and it becomes merely a vessel for the idea. The material thing is purified, while at the same time, the infinitude of the idea is voluntarily renounced in its appearance as a thing. So Benjamin, returning to that, the outline to the Trauerspiel, he says to say mean instead of is would be false. However, this is precisely what occurs in the concept of the symbol. Meaning is separable from being, and its unity is replaced by analogy or affinity. Here, then, is the origin of the arbitrary symbolist sign that dominates the sociological account from both Parsons and Habermas. The symbol is conceived as a form of intentionally positive meaning. As such, the subject gains its freedom to name, to designate objects, and its ability to independently produce meaning. The symbol's loss is the subject's gain. Accordingly, the symbol turns from a paradox, a riddle that can be answered by grasping the symbol's meaning, its essence. So within these two forms of symbol, I think there's a conflict between two different logics. On the one hand, the religious symbol works by way of real unity, while on the other hand, the concept of the symbol works by way of substitution. At the level of appearance, the reality of capitalism, money works by way of a religious symbol. As Marx insists in The Poverty of Philosophy, money is not a thing, it is a social relation concealed beneath the material's shell. The unity of the capitalist totality is confirmed in money through the act of exchange. In the act, the money symbol makes the supersensuous imminent. Money, the imaginary object in which spectral objectivity of value receives a material form, gains its appearance through the act. This is not the mere manifestation of a supersensuous idea in an object, or the substitution of a material thing for a universal, but the religious doctrine of transubstantiation made real. The object remains as it is, yet its substance is fundamentally altered. The material body of the money commodity becomes the bearer of the immaterial soul of value. On the other hand, money cannot escape its bonds to the sensuous world. money may be the transcendental concept, embody the transcendental concept of value, but is also a material thing, and as such it necessarily remains within the sphere of production. The worship of value, the sacrifice of money, and the act of exchange must always take the form of the vulgar worship of a physical thing. Just as a supersensuous concept requires a material body, the material body requires a concept in order to achieve its transcendent character. The money symbol, therefore, breaks the promise of the religious symbol. It makes the immanent transcendent rather than the transcendent immanent. Money can never completely shed its crude material form. It is the transcendence of immanence from within the immanent. As the theologian Paul Tillich states, a real symbol points to an object which can never become an object. They do not make God part of the empirical world. Thus, while the money symbol retains its qualities of the religious symbol, its momentariness, its totalizing power, the ability to conceal its origins, and its apparent necessity, the symbol is in reality the opposite of a religious symbol, a profane symbol. The money symbol does not manifest the divine being of God, but rather the exploitation and domination of the laboring bodies of human beings. The abstract and formal harmony that is found in the money symbol conceals a real state of disunity. At the formal level, its sensuousness and its supersensuousness appear to merge, but its totality, its harmony, is mediated, imposed by the outside, by the demands of a specific set of social relations. This formal unity is denied at the level of society. Despite acting as a form of synthesis, money also separates people into antagonistic classes and competitive individuals. The symbol's promise of unity, therefore, contains within itself a real state of disunity, a state of disunity that is momentarily negated by the promise of its transcendence. Money momentarily negates the realm of necessity. This promise, however, is fleeting and only momentary. In its transcendence, money redeems the brokenness of reality, just as at the moment it falls back down to earth. Yet its fleeting promise of transcendence and harmony remain, even though it must, by its very nature, break that promise. In the act, the social relations that constitute it disappear into its appearance as a mere thing. The contingent historical origin of the thing is concealed, and it confronts human beings as identical with itself, as a piece of paper or a round metal disc that is, at the same time, despite its grubby materiality, something purely conceptual and invariant. Here, money shows itself to be a symbol adequate to a form of religion without a theology, a profane and practical religion, but a religion nonetheless. As a symbol, as a thing that structures the second nature of capitalist reality, its essence constantly eludes our grasp. It pervades our everyday existence, yet it equally remains outside of it. It is both concept and object, and either side is meaningless without the other. So I think it's here that we find the necessity of grasping money not merely as a sign, but also as a symbol. The formal character of money of the money symbol reflects its own structure, but also the structure of capitalism itself. Thus, while it may appear arbitrary at the level of its form, its meaning and essence is constituted in the practical sphere of social relations, and its objectivity within that sphere precisely because of its social constitution. This is the form of symbols particular to capitalism, not the merely an arbitrary and accidental concept of the symbol that we found in German idealism, but the inverted or profane religious symbol, as I said, a symbol adequate to the fetishistic form of social practice, particular to capitalism. So I'll conclude just by returning to Habermas briefly. So I think we can now, or I can now kind of pinpoint his real problem with this understanding of money. And I think it's at least partially resides in this conflation of modernity and capitalism. Something represented is presupposition of the adequacy of the concept or modern form of the symbol. He presupposes subject free deposit meaning as his absolute. However, what he implicitly presupposes is a limited subject of capitalism, one who can suspend the realm of necessity temporarily, but who remains within the sphere of domination and exploitation by virtue of her mediation by the money form. As Marx says, the individual carries his social power as well as his bond with society in his pocket. Or, what each individual possesses in money is a universal exchangeability with which he himself can determine his share of social products according to his whims. This conception of symbol rests on a conception of reality as a collection of intentionally and transparently positive meaning. This is the imminent realization of both the bourgeois theory of freedom and language. But can this form of freedom be presupposed in a world in which money truly has become the nexus rerum et homo, a reality in which the subject's freedom is primarily expressed in terms of exchange, a reality in which reproduction of the individual is subordinated to the monetary logic of capitalism? Rather than viewing the various inversions of meaning that occur in the capitalist forms of symbols, Habermas presupposes them as harmless and necessary for a modern, complex society. As a mere sign, as a form of designation, money is contingent and arbitrary, not necessary. In contrast, understood as the rerum nexus et hominem, Marx places money at the center of social reality. It subordinates traditional structures of religion, politics, Habermas's life world, to its logic and reduces the subject to a capitalist subject of exchange. Surely the task of a critical theory of society should be representing the inversion of freedom that occurs in such symbols, not simply naturalizing. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Phil. And now I'll open the answers and the questions and answer session. So if you have any questions, just raise your hand and you'll be given a microphone.
Okay, I have a short question for Sami, and perhaps it will be a bit tangential to his talk. Unfortunately, I had to miss the beginning, but you mentioned economy as such doesn't exist, that economy is always liberal economy, political economy. Well, could you elaborate on that? Because I would simply ask, what is this concept, what is this economy that doesn't exist? Exactly, in what sense?
I mean, sure, I mean, economy exists as a phantasmatic object in the science of economy. But that would be pretty much Althusser's distinction between ideology and science. Of course, there is no such thing as economy, since economy always thrives on other so-called non-economic fields. So the whole point is, of course, economy is always political economy in modernity, so poiesis and practice are bound together, despite all the bourgeois fantasies that we are used to hear from Heidegger, Hannah Arendt, and so on. I mean, this is exactly Marx's insight, that there is no such thing as economy. And from there on, you can say the very sad misunderstanding and mainly the Anglophone reception of Marx as an economist starts. For sure, Marx is not criticizing, I mean, a kind of an echo of that insight is in earliest liberal theory still present. Smith say, you can say, there is something still there. But later on, when we have the division, capitalism as a field of division, which is of course an ideological but also real division, yeah, then you can have a separated field of economy, which is as much as an ideology as a production, as a real production of ideology. I mean, there is a field of knowledge, it's called economy. But in critical theory, of course, the first step would be to not accept this field of division. The field of division, of course, goes on if you say, I mean, the bourgeois separation has it as culture, religion, economy, and so on. I mean, these would be the fields. And ironically, you can say this was the argument of the paper, that the religion is not only the marker today, but the very resource of reinforcing these very divisions that bourgeois society needs. So this would be my meta-critique of religion. Whatever the content of religion is, as a pure marker of difference, it can reinstate the fantasy that there is something as economy. If you ask religious people, they will say, what I do in the economy has nothing to do with my belief and my identity. Yeah. Yeah, so this is exactly the fantasy how it works.
Okay. Okay.
Any other questions? Maybe I can begin. Okay, my question also refers to Sami's lecture, but I won't mind if you two intervene into the discussion. You've emphasized this pragmatic character of theology in modern capitalism, and also emphasized that there is no one adequate religion in capitalism actually produces or is compatible with heterogeneous cultures and discourses, and it even encourages it. But I'm just wondering, isn't there nevertheless like one specific form of religion, or are there some specific forms of religion which are more adequate to capitalism as others, in a sense, wouldn't the fact that, say, in 19th and 20th century, that the most developed capitalist countries were Christian, somehow indicate that Christianity, with its, you know, norms and worldview, is somehow more adequate to capitalism.
And you all know, of course, this famous Ali G or Bora video, what is better, when he asks. Yeah, in a sense, one is a little bit better than the other, when, you know, men and women. Okay, but for sure, historically, the picture is very clear. We don't have to discuss this. Once established itself, it could write its own prehistory as diachronic history from Greco-Roman civilization via Christianity, and of course then you have the other stages up to Protestantism and Calvinism. Of course, in a retrospective or retroactive teleology, it is the necessary perspective of diachronic historiography, for sure. But today, I think this we can easily falsify. There is a capitalism with Asian values, as we know. You don't even need a religion, a kind of a pragmatic set of Confucianism with some so-called, what is called Eastern spirituality, is absolutely enough. You don't need Christianity today to engage in capitalism. There is a whole set of totally pragmatic, I wouldn't even say this is theology, I would even say theology maybe in its critical kernel might be something that can even inspire materialist readings. Today, this is a boiled down, very pragmatic set. I mean, it comes with a dogmatic rhetoric, but it is a pragmatic set of what of meaning, of creating meaning. I mean, if I see this correctly, especially, I mean, the classic case would be so-called Islamic fundamentalism. Of course, this is precisely the neoliberalization of religion. In a way, there are ultra-modernists. It's not like some backwardness, but they have just reacted to the neoliberalization of religion. The Catholics are a bit behind, but you can talk to 10 jihadists and you get exactly maybe 20 or 30 random legitimizations of why, how many, whatever, what you can do, what you cannot do, how you can, you know, kill someone this way or not that way, or, you know, all these kind of totally phantasmatic, made up, ex post rationalization that are not even believed by those who proclaim them. So you cannot say there is an any attempt to bring in coherence into this is already ideological endeavor par excellence, because you rationalize this, what even those people, this is why they have produced all these kind of videos. Yeah, of course, there are, of course, non-believers, they have to produce these, at least to have someone else who may believe, at least in some kind of brutal fantasy, on their behalf, that there is something to be believed. I don't think that you can find any privileged religion today. Capitalism is absolutely indifferent to it, but the way how you can rationalize it, this is, of course, very, very different. And also, the, let's put it this way, in the current power relation situation, it is of course a different thing whether you speak from a Western perspective, when you can say, I'm completely indifferent to my cultural identity. I can, because this is a norm. if I were completely, I mean, of course, I have a different name, but let's put it this way, white, male, blah, 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 European, and so on, I can say this is the norm, this is, so I'm in the neutral ground, everybody else has culture, you know? Everything is culture, but I'm in the zero level of culture, so I don't need any further cultural difference. This is only for, you know, underdeveloped people who need culture, and the same for with religion. Of course, this is an asymmetry of the perspective, and I totally agree. Here, you can say the displacement of religious sacralization into false profanation, so to speak, has been achieved maybe in the West to a higher degree and also in an ideologically more successful way. Of course, it's uneven development, no one would deny this, but there is no privileged place of capitalism. And this is why I quoted from Vivek Chibar. I think he has a good point against, with and against post-colonial theory, who still sometimes in its more neoliberal strands believes capitalism is some kind of Western culture and has no idea that the very concept of culture is produced as something the modern subject needs. No? It's the very separation of these fields. So it's basically a transcendental of that very form of subjectivity that can claim to have a religion, to have a culture, to have an identity, whatever you need to be accepted on the market.
But you should also.
I think that the fact is not that today there is a relationship between Christianity and capitalism. The fact, from my point of view, is that to understand the mechanism that is at the core of capitalism, or the new form of capitalism, the neoliberal form of capitalism, is very important. The mechanism that is at the core of the Christian institution, the way through which the Christianity, the Christian community had produced a new institution that is not in relationship with, not only with law, but with economy, but the government with itself and with freedom. This is this freedom that is not the fact that today the power is not coercive. There is exploitation, there is coercion, but it is a way really, it is very difficult to understand this way to domination in the single life, in the single way of life. No? This is
Do you think that this is a Christian trademark? I really think not. You can be, in a structural sense, a Protestant with whatever, Catholic, Islamic, a Shiite, a Sunni, Hindu, Jewish values. I know, you know, Protestantism is nothing about, you know, how you, in the Max Weber's, but also in the way of how sovereign power is played out in the state. This is amplified. This is amplified. This is the origin, or to put it this way, the validity of this form of subjectivity and the validity of this kind of form of political economy has overwritten its origin.
Yes.
So, yeah, but what does that mean? It is the Western subject still indulges in the fantasy, and that is, of course, the whole kind of very sad, guilt-driven fantasies of capitalism as a Western system that still is so-called riding the horse. They are ridden by this horse called capitalism. It has completely emancipated itself from, you know, in its parasitic nature, substituted its own origin through its own validity. So, of course, and this is kind of this guilt religion of Western intellectuals to say, yeah, we originated it, sure, but this is not important anymore. Talk to Chinese capitalists, they will say, yeah, sure, you did. You did a good job, but your job is finished. And yeah,
I think we have to react to this conjuncture. It doesn't help to repeat always again our good Christian origins of this form of subjectivity and capitalism that we have. Of course, but what does it tell us about the validity and the mobility of this very form that you can have capitalism with neo-feudal, where actually I would ask you, whether what kind of diachronic perspective can precisely say whether this is retro or neo? Because this, we don't have a linear teleology that can say this is before or after. We have feudalism together with slavery, together with all so-called stages of capitalism together, mixed up with the most recent forms, and capitalism can work this. I think the money form is here the magic tool that can do it. Yeah. So religion is in this very conjuncture. We can, of course, say that through the very form of subjectivity, Christianity and the Christian roots, the Western roots, are so formalized that you can be, this was polemical, of course, you can be Protestant with, you know, whatever kind of content you wish, but in a structural sense, you are Protestant. In the same structural sense as pure cult, as Benjamin said it.
Yes, yes. I think that, the problem is not this continuity, this development from history, from religion to capitalism. There is something that is a mechanism, an apparatus, religious apparatus. This also is the money as symbolic. And from a point of view, the political chance today is to imagine new institutions. As the origin of Christianity, in effect. That is, I think that the possibility, the view of capitalism as economic institutional power, not only economic in technical sense, in this sense, religious also, social also. This mechanism to change, to not only to interrupt in a break, not only break, as Agamben says, to return at an a pure origin, for example, this is in any way the view of Agamben, no, views and a pure origin of the use and of the Christianity, and enter break this apparatus and return to the origin. I don't know if you are and from a point of view to find a new way in this now.
Yes, okay. We just have, Phil, would you like to add anything? And we have
one more
question. Okay, we have 5 minutes, like 7 minutes. Please.
Okay, first, thank you all for this wonderful panel. It was really a pleasure. And I think I speak on behalf of many of us here. So it provokes in my mind a number of comments, probably to mention here. I would maybe try to put some maybe that could be of importance. I would say that concerning the Christianity and governmentality and Foucault here, what is important, I think Foucault is maybe at best in explaining the concept of entrepreneur, as you have also accentuated, and the self-managerial, specific self-managerial practice in relation to your own experience with the and also to truth. This was the main point, I think, in this argument that he made. which is historically, has its historical roots in Christianity, and obviously some here are completely right that today you can be Hindu and completely capitalist, no problem, and to really put meaning into your capitalist life and practice with a set of Hindu beliefs or whatever. But I think this specific origin of relation to truth and one's own experience that Foucault terms governmentality has a specifically Christian aspect which gets formalized, and this comes to the question and the whole debate on Cheaper, where I completely agree with you, but then it seems to me also not to say that maybe other religions have a certain capitalist resisting inherent traits or anything, but still that this specific governmentality that has its cultural and historical origin in Christianity, when put into practice in other cultures, also come into very specific contradictions, very specific and very different than the ones that it comes to within Europe. And here Cheaper is maybe the very weak because in analyzing resistance, he goes on to speak about the universal traits of cultures of self value of self preservance and the autonomy that exists in, for him, in all cultures, and is a basis of resistance to capitalism. But I think that he ignores the fact that capitalism is resisted in a very particular cultural way, different ways in different places, and also religions have to do something with this, and this may be an emancipatory aspect of them, also very conditional, because they can be also very very well integrated into capitalist logic. So I don't know if this makes any sense, but for me it was important. But now I wanted also to ask you something, Phil, because all of this is very, very interesting to me, but just how is your whole analysis, how is it connected to the commodity theory of money? As much as commodity theory of money is very much contested, and there is this whole topic whether Marx is dependent on it and not, and it is highly debated point, I probably you know about this. So this is one, and also other with what you said in that with capitalist form of money, money gets to play this specific role in the foundation of social relations. But and then just like a straightforward question, does this mean that money could be something else in a different type of society? Because money is much older than capitalism, as we have seen, and it is very, very interesting, I would say also analytically important, when we see the transformation of money in capitalism. Also within capitalism we can trace certain transformations of money which are pretty deep and structural. So whether, you know, whether we can think of money as something that could also exist once there is no capitalism?
Yes, this is a difficult question, but I can only shortly say that I think that this, the part of capital in Marx about money is the one of the most important in relationship with the original accumulation. And beyond of Marx, I believe that money demonstrate that the economic relationship is not only a exchange relationship, that there is something that is beyond the change relationship. That money, in the money, the relationship at the core in the money is the relationship between debt creditor and debtor. Yeah? And this is more complicated than just only an exchange. And this has to do with the fact that economy is not only economic in technical sense, and it's not only labor, it's not only exchange, but is also praxis, is also value, is also true. So, only so, because...
Okay, thank you. I'll just let Phil answer the question and then we have to conclude.
Sure, sure. Thank you. Yeah, so I think there's a tension at work in my paper between a kind of desire for like a phenomenological account of money and then the other side, the kind of abstract form of money. But I think that's a necessary tension. And in some ways, I think you have to give the substantialist his due, even if that position does eventually kind of wither away. And I think it's crucial that Marx does this. And otherwise, you have all you need in Hegel, right? Or not. Can there be some other form of money? I don't know. I would say that Marx is quite clear, like when he says as money, he's referring to the capitalist form of money. So certainly, money as, like I said, like grease the wheels of circulation existed. You know, the Roman army was using it, and but that's not money as money. And I wouldn't be super optimistic that you can either return to some kind of previous form of money or replace it, you know, a Proudhonian kind of position or something. But money's, yeah, I mean, value's the problem, right, ultimately. And so, I mean, I don't know.